This is location independent, productivity in today's environment. My name is Joe Woodard. I'm your presenter for this session. So when we're talking about maximizing productivity, it begins with overcoming obstacles. And there are five key obstacles to overcome to maximize productivity. Then we're going to cover solutions that increase virtual collaboration, so you can bring that productivity to your entire team in this work from home environment. Achieving and maintaining zero inbox tends to be a pervasive challenge. We've cracked that nut here, and I'll tell you exactly how to solve for that problem and to maintain a zero inbox. But then it all comes down to controlling task bloat, because at the end of the day, you can have zero emails in your inbox, but if your tasks are overblown, you still have a productivity problem. Now, our journey to maximizing productivity begins with those five key obstacles. We're going to address each obstacle one at a time, talk about why it's important to overcome it, and then talk about how to overcome it. The first key obstacle to overcome is the productivity myth obstacle. And there are a few key productivity myths that we all tend to believe. They're pervasively accepted, and they distract us or they prevent us from maximizing productivity in our lives and in our practices. The first one is you can manage time. You cannot manage time. And I know that seems strange, since there are about 1,000 or maybe 10,000 books that have been written on time management. It's kind of just an understood thing that we're supposed to do it. And maybe you can argue that it's semantics, because nobody actually thinks that they can manage what Einstein tells us is the inseparable space-time continuum. It'd be like trying to change the flow of the Amazon River by cupping your hands in the water. It can't be done. So what do we really mean? And is it more than just semantics? Well, what we really mean when we say we're going to manage time is that we're going to manage tasks and we're going to manage outcomes. And you could even add to that that we're going to manage priorities. But it is more than just wording. Once you change the words you're saying, you begin to change the outcomes that come from that. You begin to measure what matters. For example, have you ever said, "I'm sorry, I didn't get to that. I ran out of time"? What do you really mean? "I'm sorry, I didn't get to that. I didn't prioritize it. I didn't have the capacity for it." Well, prioritization is something we can manage. Capacity is something we can manage. That means that we're now on the pathway to fixing, to answering the question why I didn't get to that very important task, maybe even determining it wasn't very important, and that's why we deprioritized it. But then that gets us to the second myth. The measurement of productivity is efficiency, or another way of phrasing that is quantity. How many tasks can I get done in how short of a period of time? Well, maybe that's an okay measurement for certain kinds of roles. But if you're a business owner in here, if you're a manager of a practice in here, I would say if you're a professional, which is almost 100% of the people that are tuned in, then it should never be a measurement solely of the quantity of tasks you perform. What if you came home and expressed delight to your significant other that you had gotten 50 tasks done today, or 100 tasks in a single day? And what if they turned to you and asked the most important question? Were they the tasks that you should have been doing? Was there even a single task that maybe in its value outweighed all 50 or 100 tasks by itself? So the correct measurement of productivity is not efficiency or quantity, it's effectiveness. What was the value of the task that I performed? I'll give you another myth. You can multitask, but you can't multitask. It's proven by psychologists and psychiatrists that the mind can only focus on a single thing at one time. You can only think one thought at a time. But we get so good at task oscillation or task alternation that we begin to deceive ourselves and others into believing that we can actually do two things at the same time. And studies have proven that when you oscillate or alternate between tasks, however rapidly or fluidly you do that, effectiveness is diminished and often efficiency along with it. Always, though, there's a diminishment of effectiveness when there's a diminishment of focus. And as we just learned on the bullet above, the true measurement of productivity is effectiveness, not quantity of tasks performed. And then the final myth is you can give 110%. Now, I think we all know that this is a hyperbole. We're okay with that. But what we've done is we've taken a hyperbole and we've turned it into a subconscious acceptance of a reality that is no reality at all. Meaning, I think that I can do something tomorrow to compensate for a lack of attention or a lack of capacity or a lack of prioritization today. And you cannot. See, time is not, it's not that time doesn't exist. Let's get all the way back to myth number one. It's that time cannot be managed. Since I cannot manage time, I also cannot travel around within it. I cannot create more of it. I cannot compress it. I have just so much time, like the flow of the Amazon River has just so much water, and as it, when it's gone, it's gone. You never look at a river and see the same river twice. We've all heard this sort of saying before, and there's a lot of wisdom in it that applies to a lot of circumstances. The same happens with the flow of our lives. Every single day matters, and we must make the most of every day. And that means we give 100% of our effectiveness and attention on every day, not thinking that there's 110% we can make up the difference on some other day. And that applies not just to work productions. When I say give 100%, it's work and life harmonized together. So I'm going to give you a bonus myth that doesn't appear here on the screen because it's not directly tied to productivity, but I just brought it up. Work-life balance is a myth. You cannot ever achieve a perfect balance between your work energies and your life energies if you even wanted to do so. Because life is too fluid and life is too unpredictable, and the demands of work and the demands of life cannot be controlled, and there will never be a moment that is sustainable where those scales are balanced. So instead, let's use the word that matters, work-life harmonization. You can harmonize the vision, the mission, and the purpose of your work and your life into a coherent whole, or what Covey calls an independent self. And through that process, you can now give 100% to your harmonized work and life every moment of every day. Work hard, play hard. That's not two different things. That's one thing. Thomas Huxley said, "Learn what is true in order to do what is right." We must dispel all of the myths in order to embrace the truth or the reality of our lives. Or to put it into the words of another renowned philosopher of the 20th century, you must unlearn what you have learned. And if you don't know that quote, that is Master Yoda. So let's talk about obstacle number two, a lack of strategy and process with our inputs. We are in an input overload with the world we live in today. Overloaded with emails in our inbox, but beyond that, voicemails on our cell phone, texts that come into our cell phones, and every other way that people try to get our attention. As a matter of fact, just browsing around through the internet or using social media apps are all a game of trying to turn your attention from one thing to another thing in what is emerging as an attention economy. So this is not going to be a problem that will ever solve itself. As a matter of fact, more in the future than even now, you're going to have to control the inputs, control the shiny objects, and focus with laser precision on the things that matter. And that's going to take a process and a strategy with the various inputs that come into your life. So when something comes into your inbox, and we're going to refer to the email inbox as our example here, it's the most common input repository. So an immediate attention means I just do it. I see it hit my inbox. I've got a minute where I'm not task alternating. I'm just going to do it. Or maybe I'm just going to leave it in there for an hour and then do it, which is perfectly legitimate management of your inbox. Or you might say that the next is I'm going to file it. How many things are sitting in your inbox because you think you might want to refer to them one day? So you just leave them in there. And now your inbox bloat's got to be 10,000 or 15. I've seen some people with 30 or 40,000 emails in their inbox because they say, I just searched the inbox. I might want to read that one day. Well, the inbox is not designed to be a file cabinet or a catalog system, no more than its namesake. When we used to have an actual box sitting on the corner of our desk that people would put things into. The whole idea was to get them out of there, right? It was a bridge kind of a solution. This is the way the inbox should operate today. So, and I'm going to tell you exactly how to manage all of these decisions in just a minute. The point is you make these decisions with the inputs. You do it, you file it, if it's just a matter of future reference, or you delegate it, you assign it to others. Or maybe there's the schedule with intentionality. So don't just defer it like procrastination. Schedule it with intentionality to be performed at a specific time, and then make sure that when that time comes, with intentionality, you prioritize, reprioritize, and do it when the time is appropriate. Much more on that coming up. Now, there are several places that you can place these inputs, other containers besides your inbox. One of these containers that I use all day long, every day, is called the white space. That's just my name for it. You can call it whatever you want, but it's a blank sheet. It starts out blank every day. It is not a piece of paper. I do not believe in paper, not just for environmental reasons, but for task management reasons. It's not a very effective way of managing any kind of inputs. So I use Microsoft OneNote. You could use Evernote. And when I know that I need to store something in a temporary repository, I will place it into my white space. But white space can take other forms too. I'm driving down the road, I'm listening to a podcast, something's on the podcast that gets into my mind. Siri or OK Google can be a white space because I just tell them what I want to remember or the thought that came to my mind as I was reading that. And then I transfer all of those notes that they take through to my white space. In my case, I just tell them to send an email to myself and that's what they do. And then I take it from that inbox and push it into my white space. And then that gives me a holding area where by the next couple of days or so, I can clean that out without the pressure of cleaning it out every day like I do with my inbox. It's like a delayed file or delayed categorization. Then there's the personal task list. The personal task list is where I could send an email from my inbox straight through to my Google tasks or my Outlook tasks, or just even to a to-do list that I keep in Microsoft Word or OneNote or Evernote, because that doesn't have any collaborative value. It's just the things I know I need to get done. But by transferring it from the inbox over to the to-do list, I've taken it out of the bridge solution that's never supposed to be a container or storage device and placed it into a system of intentionality. Then when there is collaboration or when something that hits the inbox might involve 5 or 6 or 10 or 15 different tasks, I had one come into my inbox like that today. One email that was the result of a lot of different conversations where I got a decision from a client that resulted in about 5 different projects, all with about 15 or 20 tasks. All right, my team is working actively right now to take that email, break it apart, and pull it all into its different milestones within that project and all those different tasks within that milestone. Now, that's an extreme example. But if an email has a one-to-one, just make a task out of it. If the email is a one-to-many, or what's in your email has a collaborative impact, you may want to make it more of a project, or some people use in the CRM speak words like ticket or support case. And then you've got the note solution. The note solution can be the container for all of these things. And this is the biggest mistake a lot of people make when it comes to corralling the inputs. They think, I can't corral the inputs until I have a comprehensive practice-wide management system. And they go out shopping in the open market for one of these practice management systems. And I'm not saying don't get them, they're great. I'm saying start with a note solution, a simple shared note solution. Then you can get your processes and you can get your logic down. You can find out how your team best operates around these collaborative inputs. You can get them out of your inbox. You can control them and you can be intentional about them. then you can go shopping for something that does it in a more formal and structured way. David Allen, who mastered the four D's, three of which I just covered, do it, delegate it, and defer it, said, in order to trust the rapid and intuitive judgment calls that you make about actions from moment to moment, you must consistently retrench at some elevated level. Well, the inbox is about moment to moment. The entrench at a higher level are all the places that you get them out of the inbox and you categorize them into those various containers that I just went through. Notes, tasks, and projects. And then that's not a fixed thing. You constantly reprioritize. We'll talk about that more in just a minute. Obstacle number three is the obstacle of negative thinking. And negative thinking takes on three different time-based horizons: future-focused, present-focused, or past-focused. If I am future-focused in my negative thinking, I am plagued with fear, uncertainty, and doubt, worry, and dread. I have some sayings about worry and dread. Worry is the interest paid on borrowed trouble. And the dread of a thing is always worse than the thing itself. So if those are helpful for you, then use them. I use them almost every day in my life, anytime I'm worried about something or anytime that I dread something. But anytime that you are living in the future, you cease to be living in the present. And I don't know if you checked lately, but reality, the intersection of reality in your life is not in the future, and it is not in the past, it is in the present. But if you think you're safe in the middle square, fretting, anxiety, strife, and self-consciousness, oh, you're not safe. Because the intersection of reality in your life is not just the present. It is the present in which you currently inhabit. So it must be your current present. And all of those things pull you into some alternate present. Fretting is energy exerted over situations where we have no control. Anxiety is a similar kind of definition. Strife is mental energy exerted over the normal and ordinary frictions and unavoidable frictions of life. And self-consciousness is energy exerted when I'm focused on myself rather than the effectiveness that I need to be generating as a self. Well, all of those bring you into something other than reality. And the past-focused ones of guilt, regret, and remorse, all of those entrench you into the past. And every single person that is listening to this presentation, including the person who is presenting this presentation, has things, many things in their past where they can feel guilt and regret, remorse. Let them be your teacher rather than your chain. Don't let them enslave you to the past. Instead, let them refine your present. Now, there are inoculators for each of these, but I am fully convinced before I cover the inoculators, I am fully convinced that the psychological barriers to productivity are the leading barriers to productivity. Of everything that I'm going to talk about in this session, if you don't overcome the future-focused, present-focused, and past-focused psychological barriers, whatever your methodology is, whatever your intentionality is, whatever your prioritization is, you will never achieve your full potential. So the inoculator for the future-focused negative thinking is planning. You cannot change the future. You cannot live in the future. But what you can do is through planning, you can alter the future that will inevitably come. Well, what about the present? The inoculator there is acceptance. If I just accept the things I can't change with the fretting, accept the things that are making me anxious over which I have no control, if I just accept the fact that people are imperfect. So I've got another saying for you that we are messy people living with messy people trying hopefully to make the world a little bit less messy. And if we just accept that that's the reality, it's not a defeatist or pessimistic viewpoint. It's just an acceptance that human beings are messy by nature and you're not excluded. I'm not excluded. Let's just accept that. And then maybe we can have the right kind of expectations when people are imperfect around us. It won't have power over us. And maybe I just need to accept some things about myself that are less than ideal. I fully accept the fact that I am bald. It does not bother me at all. If I could pay a couple $1,000s and have a head of hair, might I make that investment? Sure. but it does not, it doesn't make me self-conscious. It doesn't, I don't think about it unless I'm using it as an example like this. I don't think about it when I'm on Zoom meetings. I stare at my bald head every day. I don't let my appearance or something I cannot control about my appearance ever get in the way of my effectiveness. And that's what self-conscious does. It makes me think about my baldness rather than maybe the brain full of thoughts that could help another person by sharing them through my mouth that's underneath the baldness. That's what I need to be focused on, not the things I cannot control. Or what about the past focused? The inoculator there is forgiveness. Because if I forgive myself, then I won't then be completely chained by the guilt, the regret, and the remorse. But I want to add here that forgiveness and forgetfulness are not the same thing. You need to remember the things that you didn't do well so that you never repeat them for your sake and the sake of those around you. But don't beat yourself up over them. Don't let them pull you from the present into the past. And speaking of that, Marcus Aurelius said, confine yourself to the present. So this thought's been around a lot longer than the 21st century. Obstacle number four is procrastination. Procrastination prioritizes tasks and actions solely on the basis of what is fun, what is easy, and what is predictable. Fun, easy, predictable. You could almost say yet another myth that procrastination is equal to inaction. But no, that's not the case. Procrastination is not inaction. Procrastination is the wrong actions. I'm going to say that one again. Procrastination is not inaction. Procrastination is the wrong actions. I gravitate toward what is fun, easy, and predictable. Therefore, I do the 50 to 100 things that are fun, easy, and predictable, and I avoid the one that is hard, challenging, outside my comfort zone, that will stretch me, that might be the most effective thing I can do for myself, my clients, my family in any given day. Well, when I am in fun, easy, and predictable mode, I am in a reactive solution problem. I eventually do something that's effective. But I don't do it until there's a deadline. I don't do it until there's a fear of embarrassment or a fear of failure that comes up that is larger than my fear of the thing that is not fun, easy, and predictable. Now think about that for a second. I embrace the fun, the easy, and the predictable over the hard and the unpredictable because I'm afraid. I'm afraid of failure. I'm afraid of imperfection. I'm afraid of not doing something that is excellent, or I'm afraid that I'm just going to find that I am completely inept at this other thing, or that I'm going to disappoint somebody else, or that I'm going to embarrass myself. So it is not until a greater fear of embarrassment or a greater fear of failure comes onto the scene to inoculate my fear of the hard and the unpredictable that I will act. Like maybe that 1 week out from a tax deadline. Or maybe I agreed to write an article for some industry paper. And now it's that an hour before the due date or the day before the due date. And I'm afraid of the embarrassment combined with the guarantee of failure, whereas the possibility of failure caused me to procrastinate for weeks or months. And so I scramble all night long to get something out. And then often the adrenaline gives us a positive reinforcement for our negative behavior by giving us a pretty decent article. And then we just repeat the cycle, repeat the cycle, repeat the cycle. So we move from fear to fear to fear. But instead, if I will choose the proactive solution, then I will inoculate fear. I will choose to stand in the face of fear and defy fear. But it comes through what's called a micro action. So let's say that I'm going to do something that I've never done before. If you've never written an article for a major industry publication and you've got the opportunity to do so, like the Journal of Accountancy, and you know the subject matter, but it's just fearful. It's daunting that you might do something like that. Well, then to overcome the fear, you simply start the action even though you don't feel like performing it. Start the action even though you're convinced you're going to fail at it. Start the action when you have absolutely no idea what the second or third step is going to be and all you know is the first step, which might just be turn on Microsoft Word. Okay. Start something. Do something. And then you will almost always surprise yourself with how logically steps 2, 3, 4, and 5 begin to flow. Now, I went through this recently because it's always been my desire to write a novel. Not because I want to say that I've written a novel. I don't even necessarily want to get it published. I just want to create that. And I can't paint, and I can't sculpt. So if I'm going to create art of any kind, I can't compose music, though I play the piano. So if I'm going to create something, the one thing I can create is I can piece words together and create word pictures in people's minds. It's something I have an innate ability to do. But I've always been fearful to write a novel. That always seems so daunting to me. This is a very recent example, just within the last 3 or 4 months. So as I was teaching this presentation once, or a piece of it, I thought, you know, I'm gonna practice what I'm teaching here. I'm going to create a micro action to jumpstart the desire and overcome the fear. So I pulled, and there was actual trepidation. I was sweating. And I pulled out Word, and I just typed in the first 2 or 3 sentences of something where I knew I could set up that first character's staging. Before I knew it, over the last 3 months, I've written 60,000 words. And I know they're good because my wife, who only compliments things when they're truly good, she never blows smoke, told me that this is a novel that she would read one day. So I accomplished something that I kind of in the back of my head always knew I could, but it was because I chose the simple action. Now, to give you an example that you might know from actual literature, J.R.R. Tolkien, who knew very well that he could write a novel, had absolutely no idea what novel he was going to write. He just thought, hey, how about a fantasy novel? So he wrote out a micro action. He performed a micro action. In a hole in the ground, there lived a hobbit. That's all he wrote. He had absolutely no idea what was going to come after the period of that first sentence. What emerged after that period, after that micro action, was one of the most acclaimed fantasy genre novels, trilogies called Lord of the Rings of the 20th century, making him one of the most renowned authors of the 20th century, all because he wrote a sentence. So Dr. Alex Mercer says, to perform, the desire to perform a task usually comes after you start performing that task. Now, obstacle number 5, data prisons. Anytime that there is information that lives only in a container and it is not ubiquitous and available to me anywhere that I am, especially to my team anywhere they are, then that is an obstacle to productivity. Because knowledge is power, but information is productivity. If I don't have what I need to know in order to do the information I need in order to do a task, I simply cannot perform the task. So what do? I start beating a path through Slack or Microsoft Teams to everybody in the office, trying to hunt down like Sherlock Holmes the pieces of information that I need before I can even start doing the work. Or even you yourself, by yourself. If the information isn't at your fingertips everywhere, anytime you want to get to it, then you can't be as productive as you need to be. That's why you need to use something like OneNote rather than a piece of paper. So let's talk about the data prisons. And that first one is paper. Paper is an imprisoner of data, or rather I should say the pen and the printer is the imprisoner. The paper is the prison. The liberator is a scanner, or maybe a phone with an optical capture. And how does the liberator work? It uses something called data parsing to not just read the characters, but to interpret the information that exists, the strings of information that exist on the page. QuickBooks Online uses this for their receipt capture. So they know that a receipt is a vendor name, and they know the part of the receipt that is a date and the part of the receipt that is an amount. That's called data parsing. Well, the scanners and the phone capture liberates the data off the paper and makes it ubiquitous and available and integrated. And the more that we imprison data through pens and printers, anytime you're using ink, you are an imprisoner of data, okay? The more we can liberate that, but don't think you're liberating it just by placing it in some system that isn't shared, because flash drives and hard drives are imprisoners of data too. If you place all of your information in Microsoft Word and store it on your C drive, you can't get to it unless you're in front of that particular computer. And your team can't get to it unless you're in front of that particular computer. So that's where cloud storage systems, client portals, and solutions like OneNote, if you want to talk about files stored there, but typically files are more like cloud drives, Dropbox or Box or that kind of genre. They not only store files, but they also index the content of those files and they allow you to share files or folders. Google Drive, OneNote, OneDrive, SharePoint, all of those are liberators of that prisoners, of those prisoners. Inboxes, we've already talked about a lot. Now the inboxes, you might say, well, at least they roll across. If something's in my inbox, it's on my phone, it's on my computer, it's on every computer that accesses my Google or Office 365, and that is true, but it's imprisoned nonetheless because of its volume. It's like, you know, when they wanted to hide the Ark in the end of Raiders of the Lost Ark, they didn't try to, they put it in a warehouse so full of other boxes that the way to hide it was through obscurity, right? Not through secrecy. And so if you store way too much stuff in your inbox, the thing that you're looking for at any given moment is like the Ark of the Covenant in the back of that warehouse someplace. It's buried in obscurity. But it's also not collaborative. The rest of your team can't see what you're seeing inside of your inbox. So a CRM solution, preferably one that scrapes those emails, is preferable to storing them inside your emails. And then something like Slack or Teams, Microsoft Teams, that allows you to collaborate with your team members without having to send emails to each other. And if you don't get anything else in this presentation, I want you to get, do not send emails back and forth between your own employees of your own firm. That is a job for Slack or Microsoft Teams or some other kind of collaborative solution, because that's a way of constantly keeping those conversations liberated and democratized within the appropriate permissions, including if you have Microsoft Teams, files, Slack does it too, that are stored right in that collaborative solution. No prisoners in those systems. Then voices. Our voice is an imprisoner of data. If I'm having a conversation in a meeting room or a Zoom conversation that I record, but I don't ever share the recording, or if I have a phone call with somebody, the only people who understand the data that is shared in that room are me and the other people in that room. And even then, we only retain a small portion of that information. So calls or conversations are the prison. Voices are the imprisoner. And the liberator is telephony software. So you'd be using soft phones, not hard phones, and then integrate those soft phones with solutions that transcribe and then push those through to the appropriate CRM channels. And we're going to talk about that more in just a minute. And then people. People are a data prison. Their brains are the actual prison. People imprison the data or the information in their brains. And then when their brains leave, either permanently or temporarily, that precious data walks out the door with them. So what you want instead to liberate it are shared notes through Evernote or OneNote, the CRM solution where you're documenting those phone calls, you're scraping those emails, putting in notes, and standardized processes. So the way that Jane or Tom or Dick or Harry do it, if whichever one of those is best, or maybe all four of them together create the best possible process, standardize what's in the brains of each of those people into that process, and now it becomes firm capital and it is liberated. So now that we've dealt with the five key obstacles, we can refer back to them as we address solutions that increase virtual collaboration. Now, each of these solutions does liberate data from a particular prison. So it's good that we cover the prisons first. The first one in this work from home environment you should prioritize is CRM. And a lot of accountants say, I don't need CRM because I don't really sell a lot of stuff. And I want you to know that it's not an SRM. It's not a sales resource manager. It's a CRM, a customer resource manager. In other words, in your case, client resource management, it's everything about the relationship. Resources a relationship with the client or the customer. So when you put it in that perspective, it de-emphasizes sales and it's more about delivering with excellence, documenting your relationships, making relationships stronger and stronger. When you are working in a virtual environment, the passive collection of your call transcriptions is extremely important. Passive being the key word. You're going to see it come up a lot in here. People don't use CRMs as consistently as they need to. They're in back-to-back meetings. They're trying to get effectiveness and efficiency harmonized in their workday. And it feels like if they stop for a minute and they document what they just did like a historian, they're going to sacrifice productivity. So first, you do slow down to speed up. You must not measure productivity as how many things I can get done in a particular space of time, because if that's the measurement, you will always make CRM the sacrifice. I don't have the time, you will say, to go in and document those notes. Well, you never had time. The question is it most effective for you and your relationship with your clients for you to document those notes? Is it most effective for your team to do it? All right, well, that's great. But now you still have the barrier of human nature to overcome. If your actual conversations of your phone calls are transcribed by a solution and automatically dropped into, as call logs, into the CRM product, you never have to worry about documenting. It has been done and indexed on your behalf. Now at Woodard, we use a combination of AirCall for our actual phone calls and Zoom for our web meetings. Those are all integrated with a solution called Otter AI that transcribes those different voice feeds automatically cloud to cloud, and then they automatically send those transcriptions through to the proper HubSpot contact. How could they possibly know? Zoom knows the email address. AirCall knows the phone number. As long as the phone number and the email address are in that contact's record, these solutions, Otter will find it and place it right in. And if it can't find it, it will put it in a queue and tell us where to go place that into which customer's record. What about passive meeting event collection? So maybe you log into a ticket for a case that you're trying to resolve, or a ticket you're trying to resolve, or a task you're trying to do into your project management system, or your CRM might have project management. And you know something's on your calendar, it should be scraped off the calendar by Gmail or Microsoft 365 integration, placed into that record so you know the next thing is that meeting with that client. That could be done through an integration between Zoom and HubSpot. Or passive scraping of emails. Every time an email goes back and forth across all of the different email clients of the 16 members of the Woodard team, every email is captured in HubSpot. If that contact doesn't exist, HubSpot creates it, scrapes all the information out of the email signature that it needs in order to fill it all out automatically, and places the email into the contact's record. And I've made it very clear in my employment agreements that if you send any personal emails across your company domain, doctor's appointments or emails to your aunt or uncle, they're going to get scraped. They're going to get put in the CRM. We'll try to clean them out. But don't use your company email address for personal matters. As long as that's documented in your privacy and security statement, you have no problem scraping 100% of the emails. Just communicate it with your team. Same applies to your customer support calls. They need to know they're all recorded, they're all transcribed, and they're all pushed to the CRM. So then you've got passive recording of purchase activity. So every time somebody buys something from you, however they pay you that money, maybe you use Bill.com's accounts receivable module. Maybe you use QuickBooks Online's invoicing tool for online payments. Whatever it is, that thing, QuickBooks Online, Bill.com, or whatever you're using, needs to talk to your CRM. So everybody has visibility into the account status who needs to see that, like sales and customer support. In our case, we use Stripe. Stripe talks to QuickBooks. Stripe talks to HubSpot. Stripe talks to a lot of things. We have them all tied out and integrated around. Interactive management of your e-signature. If you're mailing stuff to clients, or they have to take something you've emailed them and you're scanning, and they have to scan in a paper signed signature, that's just cumbersome in today's world, not nearly as strong of a signature as using an e-signature solution. So with that, HelloSign, but HelloSign talks to HubSpot. So we can send a document out for signature, like a non-disclosure agreement, straight out of the contact's record. We can monitor if they've signed that non-disclosure agreement right within the CRM. And once they've signed it, the signed document gets placed right into their contact record. And then interactive customer purchases, which is like QuickBooks Online talking to HubSpot, which it does. Now, this is different from the clients paying me something. This is like me sending out a quote or an estimate or a change order to a client. I can do that straight out of my CRM, and it creates an invoice in QuickBooks Online. But more importantly than just the automation behind it, it's the visibility. Everybody who then can go in and see that customer's record in the CRM sees they have that quote, sees if they've signed that quote electronically, sees if they've paid against that quote because it's constantly talking to QuickBooks Online. Everything is visible. Everything is visible and transparent within the company because information is the predecessor to productivity. And finally, I want to say collaborative projects and tasks. So teamwork is what we use for our more complex projects here. That talks to HubSpot and everything just gets wrapped up in a bow. You're seeing how all roads lead to CRM because CRM is where the ultimate collaboration takes place. So for QuickBooks integrated CRM solutions, I have some Woodard recommendations for you. I suggest exploring HubSpot, Carbon, Method CRM, and Insightly. They all talk to QuickBooks Online. They're all great products to consider. And when you have a CRM, you have liberated data from email, calls, and brains, three key prisons. Let's talk about more data liberation. Solutions that increase virtual collaboration also include parsing solutions, those solutions that extract the information off the page and interpret it. Well, bookkeeping automation is an example of that. Some examples of bookkeeping automation are Receipt Bank, Auto Entry, and VicAI. But QuickBooks Online's own Receipt Capture is an example of bookkeeping automation through data parsing. Expense applications extract information off of a receipt, off of a piece of paper, liberate that data, like Receipt Bank, Expensify, Tally, and Certify. Payables automation extracts the information off the vendor bill that is sent as an email attachment or scanned in because they're still mailing it, and that's bill.com, Tipalti, or MineralTree. All of the solutions on the right talk to QuickBooks Online. Indexing of scanned documents. So just scan it in and place it into some kind of a storage container. At least it's been liberated and you can search on it. You can search on the information that's scanned from a piece of paper. It's through optical character recognition combined with parsing. OneDrive, SharePoint, eFile Cabinet, and a wide range of others will do that. Then there are note solutions that parse data, like OneNote and Evernote. But by using these solutions, you have liberated the data from paper and from local files. Mostly from paper, but local files, we need to make sure that's mentioned there because it also is addressed. Then there are collaboration solutions. Team collaboration, like we mentioned Slack and Microsoft Teams. And then there's client collaboration, Lissio and Client Hub. Now these may be two names you've not heard of before. They're the only two that sit in this particular category with QuickBooks integration that I'm aware of. But it's mobile-first client collaboration, where they don't send you a text. You don't want your client necessarily having your cell phone number, and you want to be able to place boundaries around your professional and personal life. But they can, nonetheless, send you a message through Lissio or through Client Hub, or just take a picture of a file and securely send it. Because if your clients are sending sensitive information by email, whether it's attachments or text, you need to tell them that's extremely insecure, and it is highly likely that that email traffic is being scraped by bad actors. But solutions like Lissio and Client Hub are point-to-point. And they cannot with anything close to the access of an email, hack into Lissio or Client Hub to get that valuable file attachment or that valuable information scraped out of a client correspondence. But then there's client portals. That's a category you might be more familiar with. E-file cabinet, share file, smart vault are all examples of file portals. You place a link on your website, put it in your email signature. They can send the file straight up to your portal, bypassing email that way. Now, typically, if you have a client collaboration solution, you don't also have a client portal. Some people choose to have both. But the nice thing about a client collaboration is you have the ability to do the files. They also have scan capabilities. And they have that sort of you're the advisor in their pocket. They can get to you anytime that they want within the proper boundary set on your side. Then shared notes, back to Evernote and OneNote. You're going to see that pop up a lot. If there's one solution that you want to implement to move the needle the fastest on data liberation, it would be OneNote or Evernote, company managed, shared across all of your team members. Start there, then fold in the other elements. Here, with collaboration solutions, data is liberated from local files, email, and brains. Now that we know that the solutions liberate the data so that the team can interact with each other in virtual environments without having to worry about the fact that the documents are stored on this person's hard drive or they're sitting in a file on this person's desk or back at the office that I haven't been to since March of 2020. All right, now we've liberated all that data, we've pulled it to the cloud, we've indexed it, we've made it accessible, we've democratized it through standardized process, CRM, and integration. Now what are we going to do about that crazy inbox? Because all that's great, Joe, but you know, I haven't been able to focus on anything else since you mentioned the 10,000 emails because I'm one of those. And even if you're 1,000 emails, even if you are 10 emails and they went from yesterday to today, you need to pay attention to this segment. I started teaching this presentation with zero emails in my inbox. I don't stay there forever. Presentation is over. I'm going to go right back and there'll be more emails, but they won't stay there for long. And I will not go away from my desk and close it down for the night without zero inbox. I achieve zero inbox about 5, 10, 15, 20 times a day, depending on the day. And it's a constant curation process to keep it cleaned out. But I maintain it through that constant positive pressure. So let's talk about how to achieve and to maintain zero inbox. And step one is to adopt a note solution. We're back to Evernote or OneNote. If you don't have Evernote or OneNote or something similar, you will never be able to achieve and definitely never be able to maintain zero inbox. As the emails come in, remember the white space? I'm just going to place it out of my white space and deal with it a little bit later. Push it straight from your inbox. It doesn't matter if you use Google or Microsoft. Both of those talk to OneNote. Both of those talk to Evernote through integrations. Just click the button to the note solution. Send the email straight through to the note solution and make a reference right there on the page of when you plan to get that done. You could also send the email through to a task and accomplish the same thing. But without the note solution, you'll always have a tendency to hold on to those things that are reference points for you. Remember that? I just don't want to lose the valuable information or a link to that great article or whatever it may be. And you're trying to use your inbox for knowledge management. Don't. Use a note solution. But don't let the note solution be its own form of data prison. Share the notes whenever you possibly can with the rest of your team. Store the emails where you need to track a response. Maybe email replies and delegated tasks, and then store emails that you'll act on later, like deferred tasks. Now you could push those to Microsoft Tasks or Google Tasks too, but since you're using OneNote or Evernote, just have three different buckets over there. Temporary holding space, white space. Here's my space where I'm waiting to do something or waiting for somebody else to do something, more like the second one. And here's my one where I'm gonna get to that next week. Three little buckets I send my emails over and get them out of my inbox. Then the second step is to remove all of the emails that are older than 60 days. So the first one was just adopt the solution. We haven't touched the inbox yet. I was just telling you how it works on a regular basis. You adopt the note solution, step one. Just pick it, that's easy. OneNote, Evernote, you can do that right now. Just say whichever name you like the best. Do you like Microsoft better? Go there, you're already Microsoft 365, Evernote. You can get step one done right now, just pick it. We'll give you a minute. There we go, you got it? Evernote, OneNote, you're done with step one. Step two, remove all emails that are older than 60 days. This is the cringe factor, but this is the logic behind it. If an email is older than 60 days, then you almost certainly have had some follow-up email take place within the last 60 days because somebody wanted to know if you died or fell off of a turnip truck, as we say down here in the South. So somewhere in the 60-day horizon, they've pinged you again, maybe even said that famous line, I'm going to move this to the top of your inbox. Remember that one? And they did. Okay, so that's probably in your short-term horizon. Or if it's not, it's an opportunity you're not going to get back. 2 months might as well be 2 years, especially if it's new client work or it's a deadline the client had that you missed. That deadline's gone. Okay. And if it makes you feel a little bit better, don't delete them. Just move them to a different folder that says older than 60 days. Use the date reference I give you here on the slide. And then promise yourself you'll go back and read them one day. You won't, but you never were going to read them anyway. That's the point I'm trying to make. But as long as they live there, the 10,000, 15,000 emails, you'll never have the hope necessary in order to go through to step three. In step three, you're going to group the emails that remain within a 60-day horizon by sender. Then you are going to run the Ds, the delete it, delegate it, file it, defer it, all the way back to one of the first slides I gave you, the delegate it, delete it, store it, or defer it. You're going to make that decision about each and every one. Now, you group by sender because a lot of times you can just make a simple reply to one person, knock out all four or five emails that are in your box with four or five bullets, consolidate it into a single reply, delete four or five things, you're done. Sometimes you can do the same thing with one task, can encapsulate four or five emails. You're done. I don't like grouping it by thread though, because there might be four or five threads that can be handled with one task or one email reply. So group by sender, and then you can start to really knock those things out in broad strokes. Then use boomerangs. Boomerangs are a concept of I'm waiting for somebody else to do something. I'm waiting for it to come back around to me. And boomerangs will not only give accountability to the people that you have, that you're waiting on, whether it's a client or a team member, but it also gives you mental clarity of knowing that you don't have to retain that in your brain. It's stored in a system that you're gonna check on a regular basis. Today is Friday, and every Friday I look through my boomerangs list. There were 20 things where I was waiting on somebody else to get back to me. I pinged all 20. Five of them got back to me, thanked me for reminding them. Two of them led to fresh work. What if I didn't have a boomerang list? It meant that I would have tried to hold on to all of that in my brain the whole week. I would have failed to do it perfectly. I would have probably lost revenue and along the way, a lot of mental clarity. And a boomerang list can just be as simple as pushing the emails where you're waiting on a response out to a OneNote area, a container in OneNote or Evernote, and checking it on a regular basis. Now, how do you maintain zero inbox once you've got it down to zero? Well, there are several do's and don'ts. Do consistently deploy those four D's. Delegate it, delete it, do it, defer it. And actually use the order that's written, not the order I just spoke. Delete it if it's not valuable. Delegate it if it's something someone else should be doing. Do it if you can do it without interruption or multitasking. Defer it if you can't do it. Then trust your note solutions and tasks, but check them proactively and systematically. Because if you move them from your inbox to a system, tasks, notes, projects, and you don't proactively check those tasks and projects on a regular basis, you will not trust your system. If you stop trusting your system, you will start dropping balls and you'll start trying to pull all that back into your brain and you're going to lose all the benefit of the system that you've adopted. If you need a reminder, set global daily reminders to go out and check your boomerangs list or to go out and check your task list. Don't set a reminder for every task you're supposed to perform. All you're really doing is bothering yourself with dings throughout the day that you just end up ignoring or snoozing anyway. All right, make the times you do use a reminder very, very important. Do not use, therefore, task reminders. Don't get behind and don't tolerate even a single email in your inbox at the end of the day. And the final topic I want to address is how to control task bloat. Because I'm fond of saying, if you want another quote, you can write down, but don't write it down on paper. That's a data prison. Pull up Evernote or OneNote because you just adopted that in the last bullet. So I'm sure you've got it fully up and running. And I want you to type down this truth that you can achieve zero inbox, but you can never achieve zero task list. As a matter of fact, if you have achieved zero task list, you probably are not challenging yourself as much as you should be. You're probably not taking on a responsibility that's commensurate with the value you can bring yourself, your friends, and the world. You need to do some more stuff, okay? And so you run out of emails at the end of every day. You run out of tasks when you die. So now it's not about task elimination. It's about task management and task prioritization. And we do that, as you might imagine, by focusing on those tasks that are most effective and most important. And that starts with a filter. See, it should never become a task at all if it is not in keeping with your vision, your mission, and your purpose. Now, those sound like they might be synonyms, but they're not. Your vision is your magnetic north. It steers your journey. It's the big, hairy, audacious goal. It's the thing you can never accomplish by yourself and you can never accomplish in your lifetime. It's bigger than you. Like this example that I might give for an accountant or bookkeeper to transform small business. You might say, well, Joe, I've transformed a small business before. No, I mean all of them on the entire planet. And to keep them in a state of positive transformation. That's what I mean by impossible to achieve. That's what I mean by something that steers your journey, but not something that you could ever accomplish. It's perfectly fine for the vision to be bigger than you. It's a compass point. The mission, by contrast, is achievable and repeatable and measurable, so you can make it better and better every single time you do it. I've given you some examples here that you can read of some really solid mission statements for accountants and bookkeepers. And I want you to think to yourself, the tasks that I take on, are they in line with these kinds of missions? Or am I so bogged down maybe in mission bullet number one that I never get the capacity? See, I almost said time. I never put the capacity or attention or prioritization on bullets 2, 3, and 4. Well, that's maybe your filter needs to be changed a little bit. And then the last one is the purpose. It should drive every decision you make. We empower small business owners. Now, once you've routed those tasks through the filter of your vision, mission, and purpose, then you need to route them through a process of timing and intentionality, because not every task is equal. It's not equal in its value. It's not equal in its prioritization, and it's not equal in its timing, the sequence by which it should be done. So in step one, I capture, and we've been talking about capture a lot today, get it out of your inbox, get it into notes, get it out of your inbox, get it into tasks, capture. But then in steps 2 and 3, I clarify, so what is the who, what is the what, the when, the where, who needs to act on this, and when do they need to act on this? Based on that clarification, I organize, categorize, create reminders, not like the little pesky ones, but in a timetable system like a Gantt chart, and I prioritize and constantly reprioritize. Then I can reflect on a regular basis as I review all of these projects and tasks, make sure that they remain priorities, make sure that anything that I've pushed back a month doesn't need to be moved forward and vice versa. And it's a breathing, living system. Then I engage, but only when I have reflected on what I've organized, because I've clarified, because I've captured. But how many of us just go straight to engage, just knocking out tasks like whack-a-mole? And then we go, we're excited because we whacked a lot of moles. Not the right moles. Probably shouldn't be whacking moles anyway. All right, so then we've got continually prioritize. And everybody here has seen the Eisenhower matrix. I'm not going to break it all down for you. This is taught in a lot of different places, but any kind of a prioritization or task management course would be remiss if I don't include it. And in this, you have quadrant 1, which is important and urgent, meaning that's going to get most of our attention. But the problem is, quadrant 2 tends to be ignored. And that's kind of the theme behind the entire presentation today, is that we ignore quadrant 2 in favor of quadrant 1. Because quadrant 1 is where all the squeaky wheels are. But quadrant 2 is where the novel gets written. Quadrant 2 is where the Journal of Accountancy article gets written. Quadrant 2 is where you begin to learn and develop advisory skills. It's that important thing that's not urgent. The micro action can stimulate activity in that place and can harmonize between quadrants 1 and 2. And then you have quadrants 3 and 4. You don't eliminate them, because if you do, you'll burn out, but you minimize them because you must squeeze every moment out of life. And that includes your work and your life harmonization. So as you constantly prioritize, you need to think about 3 key questions. What is required of me in terms of my personal responsibility? What gives me the greatest return? That's effectiveness and outcome measurements. and what gives me the greatest reward. That's back to that vision, mission, and purpose. Then we apply the 80-20 principle and we pull from the list of tasks, those tasks you plan to perform in a single day. Then you identify the 20% that are going to have the greatest effectiveness. Then you deprioritize the 80% that collectively have 20% of the effectiveness and knock out that 20% that have 80% of the effectiveness at the beginning of the day. And by doing that, and of course you could also delegate the other 80% or defer them or delete them, but by always prioritizing the 20% that generate the 80%, it means that these align and are consistently exercised through what's called the Pareto principle, the 80-20 principle, to harmonize quadrants 1 and 2 of the Eisenhower matrix. You're always going to focus on what is important and prioritize it, and sometimes what's important and not urgent. So in this presentation, we covered 5 key obstacles when maximizing productivity, solutions that increase virtual collaboration, how to achieve and maintain zero inbox, and how to control task bloat. And I've got several key takeaways I just want to revisit in one succinct slide. We manage tasks, not time. We measure what matters, which is effectiveness. We control and categorize our inputs. We take ownership of that. We take management of that. And we continually prioritize and reprioritize based on effectiveness, vision, mission, and purpose. We are liberators of data because information is a predecessor to productivity. And we're virtually collaborative, which has never been more important than in this work from home environment. Well, that wraps my presentation. Thanks for watching. Have a great rest of your day.